Hi everyone, welcome to the another lecture of this mini revision series of ancient history. As you all know, we are studying about Jainism and Buddhism. So for a quick glance of what we have studied yesterday, let me go through it again. We have studied about background of Jainism and Buddhism, then about Vardhaman Mahavira and Buddha. The important facts that you have to remember is about 24 Tirthankaras, then here Alaraka and Udaraka, who are the teachers of Buddha, then the name of his favorite horse, that is Buddha's favorite horse, that is Kantaka, and other facts that you have to remember is from which clan Buddha and Vardhaman Mahavira hail from. Buddha hails from Shakya clan and Kosala dynasty his mother belongs to. Then Vardhaman Mahavira is from Jantrika clan. So these are the facts that you have to remember from yesterday's lecture. Now let's move on to today's lecture and today's topic, that is doctrines of Jainism and then doctrines of Buddhism. Let's study in detail about each of the doctrine in each of the heading, that is in Buddhism and in Jainism. So there are four doctrines in Jainism, and these doctrines are based on universal truth. The first doctrine is nothing but Pancha Maharatnas or Pancha Mahavratas. These are also called as five principles. They act as a code of conduct for the people who follow Jainism. Following this code of conduct is called Anuvrata, and not following this will lead to karma, and soul with karma will not attain liberation. This is the main point that you have to remember in this first doctrine. All these five doctrines are already learnt in the first lecture itself, in the first point itself, when we are studying about Parshvanatha. If you did not go through first lecture, please go through it and then come back to this lecture. So I think we need not discuss these five principles again. So not following these five principles will lead to karma, and soul with karma will not attain liberation. Means if we do not follow these five cardinal principles, we will do karma due to our deeds in day-to-day life, and then we'll accumulate karma, and then our soul will not be able to attain liberation. That is the meaning of this line, and what causes this is not following five principles of Jainism. Those are Ahimsa Acharya, Asakya, Apanigraha and Brahmacharya. Then let's know what is the karma concept in Jainism. See here, the karma is explained like this. Bandha. Bandha means bondage with material things, leads to Asarava. Asarava meaning this is the reason for soul to generate karma. That means bandha, bondage, is the reason for the soul to generate karma. And karma, as we have studied before, will not allow us to attain liberation. So what is the way to attain liberation? Means following all these five principles. Fine, we'll follow all those five principles, and then will stop karma to happen. That is called Samarava in Jainism. That is stoppage of karma. Well and good, we'll follow all the five cardinal principles, will not accumulate karma from now. It's good. Then what about the karma that is accumulated from our past deeds? For that also there is a solution in Jainism, that is penance. See here, karma can be annihilated by penance. Penance is nothing but punishment. So with punishment, we can shed away the karma that we have accumulated through our past deeds. So that shedding away of the accumulated karma is only called as Nirjara. So this is the concept of karma in Jainism. So let's move on to the next doctrine of Jainism, that is acceptance of God. So in Jainism, they accept God, but they give lesser status than Jaina. That means status of Jaina is above the God. That means Jaina is superior to the God. So this is the concept of God in Jainism. When you remember, Buddhism is silent on the concept of God. Fine. So let's move on to the other doctrine, that is liberation. Liberation in Jainism, we can attain liberation through Kaivalya. Kaivalya through Triratnas. Triratnas are nothing but the path that have given by the Jainism for us to attain Kaivalya. So these Triratnas are nothing but samyajnana, samyakdarshana and samyakcharita. Those are nothing but right knowledge, right faith and right action. When you are approaching right knowledge and having right faith and then doing right action, you will definitely lead to kaivalya. This is what said in the third doctrine. And there is something related to these three ratnas again. So what is that? See, not following this. However, who has kashaya, that is passion towards anything, will not attain kaivalya or liberation. There are four kashayas. Here, passion means your love and attachment to the material thing. So having passion or love or attachment to any of the material things, then also you will not attain kaivalya. So there are four kashayas. Those are krodha, lobha, mana and maya. Krodha is anger, lobha is greed, mana is ego, maya is deceit. And this concept is explained in Sarvata Siddhi in Jain text. It is a Jain text called Sarvata Siddhi. So in this text, it is mentioned. You have to remember this text, that is Sarvata Siddhi. Then let's move on to the other doctrine of Jainism, that is considering everyone as equal. Here in Jainism, everyone is considered equal. However, they do not oppose Varna system. In Jainism, they did not oppose Varna system but sees human values in Chandala. The word Chandala refers to the lower class people. However, they opposed rituals and sacrifices that are made in Vedic Dharma. Here, it also says birth in upper or lower Varna is the consequence of previous birth. When you observe this keenly, you will see a similarity between Jainism and Vedic Dharma. Even Vedic Dharma says your birth in upper or lower Varna is the consequences of previous birth. Because of the deeds that you have done in your previous birth, you will take birth in upper or lower Varnas in this birth. So that is what said in Vedic Dharma, and it is also said in Jainism. So it is the similarity between Jainism and Vedic Dharma. This is a very important point that you have to remember. However, anyone can attain Kaivalya in Jainism. This is also said in Jainism. So here ends the doctrines of Jainism. Let's move on to the doctrines of Buddhism. These are very interesting and typical also. So here we go with doctrines of Buddhism. There are five doctrines in Buddhism. Doctrine number one. This doctrine number one deals with four noble truths. Those truths are: world is full of sorrow. This sorrow is because of desire and lust. Then what should someone do to overcome this? Is the third point, that is Dukkha Nirodha. How to overcome this sorrow is the third point. Then the answer for this question, how to remove this sorrow, is for Ashtanga Marg. This Ashtanga Marg is nothing but right view, right intention, right speech, right actions, right livelihood, right mindfulness, right effort and right concentration. There are eight of this righteous things that you have to do. So this eight is nothing but Ashtanga Marga. Ashtam is eight. So this concept of Ashtanga Marga is mentioned in a text called Dharma Chakra Parvartana Sutta. So this is a very important fact that you have to remember. Dharma Chakra Parvartana Sutta has mentioned about the Ashtanga Marga of Four Noble Truths of Jainism. This is about doctrine number one of Buddhism. So, the next one, doctrine number two, that is Nirvana and Mahapanirvana. Nirvana, a state of bliss by controlling mind and connecting to the consciousness. Here, the term Nirvana means being in a state of bliss by controlling the mind, and your mind will be connected to your consciousness. Here there will be extinction of your desire. That means there will be no desire. See, when there is no desire, there will not be any attachment to the material things, and then it will be easy to attain liberation. So this word nirvana means a state of bliss by controlling mind and connecting to the consciousness. This is an important thing that you have to remember. Then mahapanirvana. This means leaving physical body and connecting to the infinite consciousness. Means this happens only after the death. You may be even confused with these two terms when given in the exam, nirvana and mahapanirvana. Please do not get confused. Nirvana happens when you are alive only and when there is extinction of your desire. And then mahapanirvana happens only after death. Your consciousness, your self-consciousness will be connected with the infinite consciousness of the universe. So that is about mahapanirvana and second doctrine of Buddhism. Then comes the third doctrine and the most typical and interesting doctrine as well. This is called theory of caution. Theory of caution is nothing but cause and effect theory. In simple words, we can say it as cause and effect theory of anything that happens in this universe. So this is called Pratyasamutpada. So this is a Sanskrit word. Parityasamutpada. However, Parityasamutpada, this is a Pali word which is actually used by Buddha to describe this. So let's learn about this. So here the cycle starts. Suffering. Suffering is due to birth, and birth takes place because there is life after death. So what is the reason for rebirth? That is life after death. So the reason for rebirth is attachment to the world. If you are attached to the world, there will be karma accumulated and then you have to again reborn to suffer. So these attachments are due to the extreme will to have something. This extreme will to have something will be developed due to experience of pleasure. See, whenever there is pleasure, we will develop that want to have something. So this pleasure is nothing but due to the senses. This pleasure is, so the experience of pleasure is through senses, and we will have this senses. See, here we can sense because there are six organs. So reasons for having these six organs is nothing but embryonic body with mind. See, this is a very important point. Embryonic body is nothing but, they are talking about cellular level. So we have every living being will have a cellular body. However, only a human being or only few animals will have consciousness, that is mind. See, embryo is mindful because consciousness of embryo. This is what I have said. There is consciousness of embryo, and this consciousness exists because of karma that we have accumulated in previous birth, and this go on repeating like this, and we accumulate karma because of lack of knowledge, and this goes on repeating like this, and we will be suffering without knowledge. Whenever we attain knowledge, that is only called as liberation. I think it is clear. One more thing I want to tell is that for your easy understanding, I have not read all these Sanskrit words, but please pause the video and please go through all these Sanskrit words for even more better understanding, or for prelims point of view questions, because we get to see terms and their meaning will be asked. So please go through all of these terms. Then there is doctrine number 4, that is no soul theory. So there is nothing much to discuss about this. Buddhism does not accept the theory of soul, but they accept the theory of rebirth. That is what said here. And doctrine number 5 is nothing but code of conduct for upasakas and bhikshus. Upasakas are nothing but followers of Buddhism, and bhikshus are nothing but monks. So there are 5 code of conducts for followers of Buddhism, that is upasakas. Asakya, ahimsa, acharya, no toxicants, no corrupt practices. And for the monks, there is buddham sharanam Sangam Sharanam, Dhammam Sharanam, which means teachings of Buddha, philosophical exposition, woes of Apanigraha, and then rules of Buddhist monks. This is about the last doctrine of Buddhism, that is code of conduct for upasakas and monks. Now I want to tell you about other playlists also in Vaish YouTube channel. Please go through them. It is a very innovative series that Vaish sir has taken up. Please go through all the videos and playlists, and also for test series, please mail or WhatsApp to this number, that is 7200681675. You will get all the introductory videos as well as the test series samples. Please go through them. They are very worthwhile. And thank you for hearing me till now. And we'll continue to study the other things of Jainism and Buddhism in tomorrow's lecture, that is causes of rise and fall of Buddhism and Jainism, and then contribution of Jainism and Buddhism, and so on like this. Thank you so much.